So today we talk is about continuous packaging. So I'm Frédéric Lepied. Just a quick introduction. I work at Red Hat in the OpenStack group. I was working in an OpenStack company acquired by Red Hat. I've been in the open source world since a long time. I'm feeling old today when I read this, but that's mine. So I'm the author of RPM Mint. You can blame me for this at some point. Sorry about that. I've been involved in a lot of different things. In Debian a long time ago, Mandrake Linux, and lately more OpenStack related open source projects. So I've been doing build system, packaging, CI, a lot of things since too long, I can say. So a quick survey. Who is a packager? I suppose everybody is a packager here. With packaging some upstream project that is moving very fast, a lot of commits every day. Yeah, some of you. So this talk is to address this kind of project, so where you have a lot of different commits and you have a hard time to catch up, and how to cope with this kind of problems. So the talk is divided in four parts: introduction, why we do this, and an explanation of one way to do it, and going deep into how it works under the hood, and what will be the next step in Fedora, and what we could do together. So the vision of all this is that integration, packaging is doing integration. We gather some bits from different parts and assemble them, compile them, package them, and then we tie them, and we are doing integration. And the state of art in integration is continuous integration. But in packaging, we are not doing this. We are doing integration at point in time, at various point in time, not in a continuous way. So the idea was to bring to packaging the state of the art, that is continuous integration. That's why the continuous packaging world came up. So traditional way of doing packaging is that you wait for a new release happening upstream in your project that you are monitoring. Sometimes you are packaging an RC or release candidate just to look at what has changed, and you test your new package, and then you report any problem you have found upstream. You try to fix. You backport the patches because the release has already happened. You backport the patches to your current version, and then you can release the package to Fedora. That's basically. Do you agree on this? Or that's the way you work. No? Yes?
Kind of.
Oh, do you take weekly snapshot, and how do you work with your upstream project?
Depends on the upstream, really.
Yeah. That's why I'm asking. Depends on the speed and the pace of the upstream project. So. But usually, that's bad practice in the agile world, the XP world. It's a bad practice to do this big bang integration. And to try to discover all the things at one point, it's very difficult because you discover a lot of problems. And if you could do it little by little, it's much easier to spot what has changed, because less has changed, and you can adapt your packaging work to this small change, and then continue little by little. Because at the end, when you have a big new version that is coming, you have tons of changes and you have tons of problems, basically. So what do we do? We do continuous packaging to solve this. And we did it for 3 years in the OpenStack group. The idea, the big issues that we had is that we have a huge number of packages that are moving very fast every day, multiple commits in all the projects. The release cycle was 6 months with a fixed date, and we wanted to be ready at the end of the month, of the cycle. So last release, it was 20,000 commits, on all the projects that we were monitoring. It was a lot of changes, and everything can be broken by any of these changes. And we had also a big issue is that we were developing installers, and installers were needed the packages to be able to function. So we had a chicken and egg problem because the installer needed to consume the last bit, but it was not packaged, so they cannot really start to work until the end of the cycle to test the last release, so it was difficult. So what did we do? We created something called DeLorean. We don't use DeLorean as a name because it could be trademark, and so that's DLRM. But I will say DeLorean. So we switched to a continuous integration mindset. So it means that each time there is a commit in the upstream project, we build a package. Okay, and this package is not only built, it's tested to be installed. We run the unit test during the build phase. And at the end, we create a repository that can be consumed by the CI systems and by anybody to do installation. So it could be the installer, could be the CI system just to do some tests. And the good point for packagers is that the system is in a reactive mode. You don't need to bother about it. It will build automatically these new releases of packages. And when something goes wrong, that's the only point where you are alerted. At the beginning, we were alerted by an email. So something goes wrong in your package. I don't know, some dependency has changed or something is broken in the unit test in the package build. You get notified. And now we went one step further, is that we are creating a new Gerrit review that is representing the failure, and you just have to amend the Gerrit review to have the thing fixed, and then the loop start again if you're fixing your spec. Or if it's a fix upstream, you fix it upstream, and then when the new change is coming back, you have your fix implemented and built automatically. So it's a stream of packages that are coming.
And what happens to the Gerrit review one?
No, you have to close. You just discard it. That's it. There's no problem. So you can take a look at this URL. You will see a status report with all the the packages that are in that are managed by the URL. So with the idea of all this atomic CI pipeline, the idea was to try to see if we could apply the same thing to Fedora and see if we could have the same system to monitor what is happening upstream. So what I did is that I started an experimental DeLorean server for Fedora, and I picked two fast moving targets. So I picked Ansible and systemd, very different. And to see what was the benefit to do it. So in Ansible, they are moving very fast. A lot of commits every day. You have some issues that they don't track in their CI because they don't do release every day. So, and when we do packaging, we take the bits that are done like it was a package that is being created as a released tarball, and they don't spot this kind of thing. For example, there were multiple issues with unit tests. For example, one of them was doing some network connection during the unit test, and we spotted this very easily. And we had also some issue with unit tests that were depending on some Python dependencies that were not installed and that were not documented. So we catch all this and during this with this build, and we reported it upstream and fixed it upstream, and then it was fixed. And we found also a release issue. They were doing some symlink magic, and when the tarball was created, the symlink disappeared. So we could not at the end use the tarball, and the unit tests were failing. Systemd, we didn't find any issue with unit test or whatever, but they changed their build system. So the spec file was not working anymore, so we spotted it and we created a new spec file. We adapted the spec file to cope with this at the right time, that was easy to track and not wait at the end for the new system release. So that's how it looks. You have I took the screenshot at the moment where systemd was started to fail, so you see the failing commits. And for each line, that's a commit upstream. So you have a direct link, you can take a look at the commit. And that's the timeline of what has been built. And you have also the repository that is available and the build logs. It's a mock output, and that you can take a look and inspect if you want, if you need to inspect what happened. You don't really need to operate on the server. And
this report generated by two of what does DLR mean? Is that the name of the two?
What DLR mean?
Yeah.
Which error?
I mean, the URL is
the name of the tool.
Yeah, DLRN is the name of the tool, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
But you can put it on any URL on your server, but just I choose this one. But that's just an experimental server. Yeah. And you have also a synthetic view summary where you can see what's the status for all the packages that you are tracking in your server. And this way you can see that it has been 10 days to fix the issue in the systemd.
And where are the builds actually being done? Is that happening in Fedora's Koji or is that?
No, it's on a mock server.
Okay.
And it's a local mock instance.
Okay.
Did you restrict the mock server to not do network connection or?
Yeah, and on the new versions, that's what it's doing now, by default. That's where we catch this issue.
Yeah.
We change the version of mock and then, oh, we have an issue. So if we go deeper, how it works, it's we have a file to describe the server settings, like the URL, where the files are located on the disk. We have a standard mock config file where we describe what is needed for a mock, and I will give an example. We have a YAML file, that's the important bit where we describe all the different packages and where this Git is located, where the Git repository for the upstream project is located, and the branches we are using, because some projects are weird branching names, and we need to cope with this. So how it works at a high level, DLRN is fetching all the repositories that are listed in this YAML file, extracting the upstream and the disk.git. Then it's building a package using mock on these repositories. And then it's creating a successful build and install with mock. It's built a repository with all the packages inside. And it's saving space by using symlinks to avoid copying around all the files and doing some magic around with symlinks. Yeah.
Do the versions of the RPMs track the versions of the upstream products? Like are you doing some magic to
update spec on? Yes, that's what we try to do. That's not always easy to guess the next version of a project. Some are well defined and some are not so easy to guess. So sometimes we work with Git to try to fetch the last tag and to increment it, and we have some tricks to try to cope with this, but it's, that's black magic.
So in regards to watching Git upstream and rebuilding and creating a repo, that sounds very similar to a Copper. I'm not actually sure if Copper might even be able to do that.
No, I think the idea will be more to couple Copper with this at some point.
There was dgrub for that.
Sorry?
There was dgrub for that, the daily Git rebuild on Copper. That would just pull on a cron job, a server call, and try to get a spec file and it would build on Copper based on that. But that wasn't part of Copper itself.
Okay.
They could be.
Yeah. I said the good thing when you have multiple packages like we have in OpenStack is that we can do some kind of bisect also after on a CI job. So we have a bisect, but on a set of Git repositories. So we have, 200 repositories, and we can find the one that is breaking the CI, for example.
That's just for end-user testing, if you have somebody, I mean, say you're not talking about OpenStack, say you're talking about some end-user application that you don't expect somebody using it to want to rebuild it to test.
Mm-hmm.
You have a continuous list of packages that you can tell them, try this one.
Mm-hmm.
Try this one to find where the problem happened, which is actually very useful. I mean, a lot of people do that with the kernel now. It's just that we can't rebuild the kernel more than once every a day or so.
With the kernel, we have some. I tried a little bit with the kernel, but the spec file is a bit difficult to work
yes.
with. Yes, but it can be adapted. The thing is that we added also some stuff to build only on tags, so we could build all the RC, and that could be another solution to build less often.
Mm.
That's possible with DeLorean.
Do you have a way to say? So that relies on the fact that the upstream has unit tests.
Not really, no. No, that relies on that we can generate a tarball like upstream is doing during its release.
Yeah, but and the fact that it says otherwise on your testing is that it still builds, you don't know if it works.
Yes, but after the idea is to be used by the CI system. That doesn't rely on unit tests, in fact. If we have unit tests in the spec file, we will run them. Don't build, but there is no unit test. That's not a big deal. We will test it. That's a big deal, but we will test it later on by the CI system.
So the RAMs is used by the CI system to configure the.
And yes, the idea after what we do in OpenStack, we could do it also in Fedora, is that we are doing some run in the CI system and we are promoting this particular hash to be the one that has been tested by the CI system and can be used by human after. For test days or for, I don't know, whatever you want to do with your testers. So just a quick look at the configuration file. The first one is where you put your your data, where do you extract your Git repositories. And the script deal is just local machinery. The base URL, that's what you see, that's what is exported and we need it internally to generate the files. The HTML files, and then we have a bunch of variables. What is interesting is the max retries. We have some logic inside the DeLorean that is catching some standard errors from infrastructure like a network connection or something, and it retries the build. Here it's three times. And if you have, I don't know. a mirror server that is not answering, and this kind of errors that are not really related to the build, and it will tag this build as need to be retried. And we store everything in a database, and we are working on some API to expose this to be able to create nice dashboards. And that's work in progress. And fallback to master is just. If you cannot find a branch, it's going back to master. The log configuration file, you could be more familiar with this. It just installs a minimal base system with RPM build and just what is needed to build the package. Just an extract. So nothing really fancy here. What is more interesting is the file to describe the actual packages and the actual repositories. So at the beginning, we describe the release we are targeting. That's more symbolic. There is no real meaning in the names, in fact. We do nothing with FC27, for example. And after, what is interesting is that the package config and the package default are things that you don't need to replicate, that's reused by all the definition of your packages, and you can be specific or not. Here we define the maintainers, and we are two to work on this, and so we just define it for all the packages, but usually we define a maintainer per package, because that's more the way to do it, for a set of maintainers. And you define where the projects are located. Here, it happens that we are both in under GitHub, so we just specify templates that is GitHub related. But it could be, you could have multiple package configs, so it would be package default is the default for everybody. And then we have the two packages that are described here, so systemd and systemd is using master, and by default we prefix with rpm dash to see that the upstream project is using the master branch. And for example, in Ansible, we are using devel as their master branch. So we are using rpm devel. It's just a convention. We can do whatever we want. It's easier to have something regular. Any question on this? So how it works in details after in DeLorean, where the black magic is happening. So it's extracting in the data dir we saw before. So here the data dir is a raw height data. So we extract in raw height data. the upstream repository under the name of the project. So it will be Ansible, it will be systemd. And then we extract the diskit repo, or we update the diskit repo because it doesn't extract it every time, it doesn't clone every time, just update it. Under Ansible underscore distro or systemd underscore distro, and you have your spec file and the usual thing from your diskit. And then it switch to the right git commit for both that we are targeting in the build. And it's creating a tarball. That's where the black magic is happening, because it needs to guess what is the number of the of the release that will be the next, in fact. That will be the next version.
Where is, I assume each project has a different command to use for step 4. Is that defined anywhere? Or?
No, up to now we were able to do it in a generic way. So we try to do it like this. If at some point we cannot, we will make exception and we'll have something in the diskit that will describe how to extract the next version, but up to now it was not needed. And then we substitute the tarball name and the version and the spec the release number in the spec file. In the release number, we use the Fedora naming scheme for pre-release, so it's 0. The SHA-1 for the upstream, and plus the short SHA-1 for the diskit .1 to as a release. This way, if you update to the real one after, it will be to a one release, it will be okay, no problem. No, there is a timestamp, sorry. There is a timestamp, and then the SHA-1, and then the short SHA-1. And after that, it creates a source RPM from this tarball, and it builds and installs using mock, just to test using mock all the dependencies of the resulting RPM are okay. And then, on success, it creates metadata for VM RPM repository that is exposed through HTTP that you can reuse anywhere. And on failure, it's like I said before, it's sending an email or opening a Garrett review.
So it's not configured to use the other repository. So if you have package A, depending on package B, and you have already updated package B, is rebuilding package A going to use the latest version that's available of package A in Fedora, or is it going to use the one that DeLorean built?
It will use the previous one that DeLorean built. And adding the Fedora. The idea is to, and we could have, if we have circular dependency when we bootstrap DeLorean, we can have trouble, but we have also some ordering options to bootstrap a repository when it will compute the order of build requires, and then build them in the right order the first time. And then we let in build on the history of the git commits. And then on disk it's organized like this, and you can take a look on, if you want, on the website. You have a project, and where the, like I explained, the Git repository is located. The disk Git repository is under underscore distro, and then you have some under the repos directory. You have all the generated files, so it could be the logs, and the RPM build.log, it's the main one you have to look, because that's the output of mock, and you will see what happens when something goes wrong. And you have all the RPM and the repo data at the same time. It's like a Git path. So if you have a lot of packages to build and it's taking a long time because of compilation or unit test, you can have some trouble to build on each commit. So what we do in this case is that in each run, we take only the last commit of a branch, and we rebuild only this branch, only this commit. And this way, each time, if it's taking a long time, but there is not a lot of commit, you will have nearly on each commit. If it's taking a long time, but you have a lot of commit, you will have big holes in your commit history. But you are able to keep with the pace of the project. If we do it like that. I had to do it on my VM for Ansible because it was very, very fast. So, and then we have some script to do some bisect if you really want to know which commit has broken your build and not the exact one. Or you can look at the Git history yourself and using Git log and see, okay, that's this one that has broken something. But that's a reduced number of logs that you need to look at. It's not the full history of the release. So it's still better. So next step, so I want to get feedback from the Fedora community if it's useful, if you think it could be useful. So that's why I'm presenting here. Could be to put an official server with a reduced number of package to just test if it's useful for people. Involve the official packager, because up to now we did it ourselves, and just to bootstrap and to see if it brings value. We didn't discuss a lot with the Ansible or the systemd maintainers, for example, so we need to go one step further. Use the disk-git, the real disk-git repository, because up to now that was our disk-git, because we wanted to test, that was not the official one. And we'll be able to use Pagure as a way to collaborate on this. Another idea was to create a plugin for ModuleDB, MD, sorry, for ModuleMD format. This way we can describe, I don't know if it's possible, we need to look, because that's this file that I showed, that's the YAML file that is describing all the packages and the repository. We could use a ModuleDB because that's a set of packages. That could be also a good way to not reinvent another format and to reuse information. I saw that there is already the disk-git that can be put in this file, but I don't know if we can put the upstream Git repository in this file. But we need to discuss and see if it's possible. And then the idea, as always, like in OpenStack, is to connect the CI system on these repositories and see if something is wrong in advance and try to fix upstream before the release with the CI test. And up to now, that's just unit tests that are on. And we do it in OpenStack. We can do it in GitHub also. It's to even shorter the feedback loop. We need more and more resources to do it. So that's the drawback. And the idea is to catch issues before they are merged. So to be able to do that, we need to run this packaging test and this integration test, because at the end that's integration test. In advance on each proposed change. So it could be a Gerrit review in OpenStack or GitHub or a Pagure change, and we can try to build the package and see if something is broken. If something is broken, try to say, okay, guys, we need to fix something, or we need to fix the package. There's two ways to do that. So we can add a webhook to be aware that a new change is happening in the monitor project. If it's too much, there is an alternative is to download all the proposed change metadata and to try to filter in some clever way. Usually it's more, is there a new dependency, is there a new file, this kind of thing, we can just trigger on this kind of change, not on a code change in an existing module, for example. So that's one way to do it. So the big advantage of continuous packaging is to align the two cycle of packaging and development. And this way you can fix things without needing a patch that you will have to carry from the next version. And that's really changing the way we work. We work the two communities together, and then you fix things at the right time, because when you discover something and you have to see the upstream project and say, oh, something is broken, but why the release is finished, why are you coming now? And you should be alerted before. And the nice thing also is it's spreading the load of these discoveries along the cycle of the upstream project, not at one point in time. And that helps a lot. And the big thing that is very good in terms of release management, and that's what we do in OpenStack, is that we can release the OpenStack for the RDO version 1 day after the release of the OpenStack project. So we release all the 275 packages 1 day after, because we know everything is ready. We just need to pass the CI, to rebuild them and pass the CI, and then we can release. There is no surprise because everything has been rebuilt and tested all the time, and at the end of the release, oh, we can release. Here it's easy in OpenStack because that's a coordinated release. We release all the packages at the same time. But if we had to do all the packaging at this time, it would take, I don't know, 1 month to do all this and to be sure that everything is done. Here we can do it in 1 day. So that's a big improvement. So let's put continuous integration in Fedora, continuous packaging, and see what we can do together. Perhaps with the core of the system that is moving fast, and see what we can do with the kernel with things that are moving fast, and let's work together. Questions?
So,
yes.
I did have a look just quickly into Buffer. It doesn't support having a spec file in a different place than the source is actually from right now. It does support webhook, so in theory you could hook it up to GitHub, change and trigger a rebuild. But that GitHub repo right now would need to contain the spec file. I don't think it would be a huge change for them to like add a different source set to like be able to say, oh, the spec file is in a completely different place and just point to the Git repo basically. It feels to me like a lot of the functionality that I'm building, you're basically replicating copper, and it just seems like a waste. If it's gonna go into production, you're gonna try and do this, it means you're gonna have to have a lot of build resources. And you were saying, right, that even your VM couldn't keep up with the Ansible changes, and that's just one project.
Mm-hmm.
So it feels like it would be more, I don't know, just better utilization of resources to just put it in, like, okay, we have the official Koji build system, and then we have this sort of playground thing being copper, where people can either build their own projects or do the CI type builds, and we can just pour resources into it instead of just creating another system that will, like,
sure.
I don't know, it feels like that might be good.
Yeah, but the thing is that it's already existing, it's already working.
Yeah, you have to start somewhere.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
And I was not at the original creation of this tool, so I cannot speak for them. But
I think I saw some of the copper folks in around. So you might wanna.
Yeah, but I don't know if copper can do can manage a set of packages, because that's what is important here. You have a set of packages that are current that you need to build at the same time, in fact. But you need to build a repository for all these packages on every commit.
Yeah,
so.
You can. I would suggest you have a little bit of copper, because you can add multiple packages and different sources in a single repo and create a repo from. I'm not saying it's gonna, like, for example, you were talking about the bisects and like identifying very specific which bit and the reports, and there might be things that are not exactly the same,
mm-hmm.
Or might be just out of the scope of copper. That's more than likely, I would say. But at least as far as building goes, that's certainly in scope, I would say. I don't want to speak for Popper devs, but like, they already have builds that can do different type of SCM, PyPI, and Ruby gems. So this is just like a different type of SCM build.
Yeah, but that's not something really, something that is released. That's already on a Git commit.
Yeah.
So
yeah. They can certainly.
Yeah,
they already have that. Right now, that thing would need to contain both the spec and the sources. That's the only difference. If you have the spec file together with the sources, you can actually do that.
Right. That's not the case here, because that's the Fedora packages at the end. So.
I know. But look, again, just a different source then.
Yeah, okay, understand. Any other question?
So, I guess I am. So you talked one hand about wanting to look at a set of packages. And they also talked about, you know, trying to get every commit so you can buy that.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I'm curious about how that those two interact when you have, you know, I mean, I guess if there's different repositories and every package will sort of be go independently, but there might be dependence between them.
There are two levels, in fact. If you have a build issue, we do a git bisect and we find the issue in your history where the package is broken. But if you have a test, a CI integration test, and all the packages have been built, we can do a bisect on all the repositories that have been built in time and find the ones, which package has broken the CI test, in fact.
So you do bisecting on the build.
Yeah. Yes, on the build history, but at the end, that's very close to the Git history because we are building according to the Git history.
I mean, it seems probably impossible if you consider like a large, like if you were trying to rebuild, I don't know, the core platform on every commission, every project included on it.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably not.
Yeah, that's why there are some resource issues we need to balance and find the right way to do it. But like I said, it's possible to do it in head only, and we can do that. And after, we can still bisect and find which repository was working and which one was not working, because that's the same thing for CI. We cannot test in CI all the repositories.
Yeah.
We will choose the last one, try to test it, and then if it's broken, we need to go back and find the one that is in the middle but has not, that is not broken. That's a bisect at the end.
So if you were going to do this in Fedora, you would need some way to get the results of the builds in front of main daemon, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is kind of a unique situation because it's actually a test process that happens before any content is actually entered the Fedora release stream, right? It's
yes.
Like if you updated today, this would be broken and you should fix it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think we have a good model for how that interaction would work with the Fedora maintainers. Like, would you file a speculative bugzilla and say, you know, the spec file in Diskit, in Fedora Diskit, is out of date relative to the upstream code, and you should probably look at fixing it? Right?
I don't know, that's up to discussion. We could do something like that, but
so I
don't know if it would be really accepted to
because whether or not something is broken is at this moment in time is a different question of whether or not like a Fedora maintainer, wants to pull in the upstream changes into the distro at this point in time.
Yeah.
So, and it's interesting, I guess, like, think about it. If you ask some sort of Fedora, it's again, say, the class module. You ask the question, if you update every package to the latest upstream git commit, is it going to be broken? I think we all know that the answer to that is always yes. So this is something we deal with, I don't know if you've ever heard of GNOME Continuous, but GNOME Continuous is a GNOME upstream build continuous integration thing where they basically build the head of every bit within the scope of the GNOME desktop. And there, I mean, so it requires sort of two things. One is that they actually have people there gardening that, saying it's broken, whatever, or fixing it. And second, there has to be this concept of pinning, saying, okay, this particular project module is broken, we're going to bring it back to early release and fix it there, and we'll look at the other releases.
But that's what we do also in OpenStack, because sometimes something is broken, we pin it to a particular commit, and that's a standard procedure. Or we introduce a patch in packaging that is fixing, that's a patch that is in progress to fix the issue in the packaging. And while the patch is not merged, we carry it, and when it's merged, we remove it. That's another way to fix the issue.
Just in terms of resources, since this is really about, not so much about whether things build from source, which I think is probably, I'm sure, handled by other CI, but about the packaging stuff. Or in your mock config, you might want to look at some of the options around like build through caching and maybe a Ccache plugin, because that could reduce the amount of building that's actually happening and then just do the packaging steps.
Right now, it's only a small VM I was using, but we have plans to do a parallel build and to get use of OpenStack cluster, because we have some we can make use of them. And that's work in progress on this also. The difficulty is when we build in parallel, we can lose the real history. And the history could be wrong, in fact, according to the Git commits. But sometimes it's not so big deal.
Yeah, to be fair, though, build from source is, most upstreams test that, but not on system 390, BPC 64, both Indian misses and such. And that's where most of my problems come from. They test, but they don't test on everything that we expect to ship on, which is, of course, even Copper, I don't think, helps you there. But Koji does.
The system is specifically about finding problems with the packaging.
Yes, but it could be on a different architecture. It's
finding any problem that causes it to build properly.
Yeah, exactly.
Copper has E386, DB6664, and DB664.
Right.
Again, there's no S3.
Well, there's not enough S390X around, but.
Yes, but after that's the thing, that we need computing resources to do the build anyway.
There's sort of two very related problems. One, which is how we do CI on what's in this kit today, which is something we're working on extensively.
Mm.
How do we take all the disk kit commits, put them together, test that, see if it works, and see what fit works. And then the same question, if you took all the spec files and updated them to upstream. So it seems like we should try to somehow work so that we're looking at an integrated fashion. So we're doing the same set of tests across the upstream updated versions as we're doing across the versions that are in this kit.
Mm. The idea is to reuse the test, test framework and all the things that are being put in place on these repositories that should do the same result than the one that is already released, and we could have a meaningful result. We should have a meaningful result. Any more questions? I'm between you and your lunch, so. I don't want to
get this place.
Well, good. So, thank you for your time.
Thank you.